Hey class, okay, here we are again at the American Museum of Natural History. We're actually in the Hall of Mammals right now. It's very exciting for me to meet an old friend and colleague of mine, Dr. Christian Kammerer, who is a vertebrate paleontologist here at the museum that studies mammals. And so he's going to tell you a little bit about what he does, one of his favorite aspects of mammal evolution. Take it away, Christian.
Thanks very much, Justin. I'm going to actually talk about saber teeth. So I work on the evolution and sort of origin of mammals. And a lot of the groups that I... A lot of the groups that I work on have incredibly large canine teeth, these big fangs that we call saber teeth. We see this evolving independently in different groups time after time in the fossil record. And it's always associated with preying on very large, very thick-skinned animals like mastodons or rhinoceros or giant ground sloth. So you see some very distantly related mammal groups all evolving pretty much the exact same skull shape. So this is actually a marsupial, so it's like a kangaroo or a koala relative, not a cat. But you can see it has, you know, the giant saber tooth, the very short skull, the shearing post-canine teeth for cutting through flesh that you see in a true saber-toothed cat, like the saber-toothed tiger down here. In between these two is a whole array of various other mammal groups that have evolved saber teeth. This is a creodont. It's an extinct group of mammals that only lived sort of at the dawn of the age of mammals, around 50 million years ago. This is a nimravid, which is an extinct group of carnivores, so very distant relatives of sort of dogs and cats. This one, which is very, very similar to the saber-toothed tiger, is a barbarophilid. It's another extinct carnivoran group. Also, it's the same situation, giant saber-tooth, short skull, and this one even has a depression on its lower jaw to hold that saber-tooth in there. In each of these cases, they're from ancestors that had just regular short teeth, and through natural selection, they've evolved these saber teeth. And this is a great example of what we call convergent evolution. Animals that are distantly related with very different body plans, independently evolving the same features in response to the same selective pressures in their environments. Dinosaurs at the time, others were big, thick-skinned guys.
So you're saying this tooth goes all the way actually up into the skull?
Yeah.
And that's how it breaks the itself so long. Actually, it allows it to transmit really high light force.
Yep. I'm not sure. I think there's also some wacky stuff going on with their sutures, some extreme interdigitation at the back to force that strain over a wider area and less sort of pinpoint right at the base of the teeth.
But you're saying sometimes they would actually lose their teeth, like in this specimen over here. And what, I mean, if it lost its tooth, would it immediately die, or could it survive on...
This one seems to have survived a while, because there was time for the tooth, that's not a clean break, to have sort of healed over and even abscessed a little bit.
So they called this one snaggle tooth or something, right?
This is actually just the regular saber-toothed tiger, Smilodon fatalis, that you get in the tar pits.
Seemed like a pretty formidable prey, and it would use those sabers to subdue the prey by going for the throat or
probably raking across the sides
and the belly
and trails. It would be hard for these animals to bring down prey like a living lion with the suffocating bite across the trachea.
Yeah, that's what modern lions do.
Yep. Yeah. Okay. Most of the big cats, that's their
go-to
attack. With these guys, they were actually a lot lower to the ground than their typical prey. So when you're dealing with something like an elephant or a giant ground sloth, you're going along the flank and the side of
it. Trying to cut open the entrails.
Yeah. Okay. Sort of the exact mechanics of the strike and what part of the body they were going for is still really argued over among.
Yeah, well, you can't go back in time, unfortunately, and videotape it, can you?
There are tooth marks on, like, mammoth. Sort of ribs that are probably from something like this.
Oh, that's cool.
So that's some circumstantial evidence, but we don't know if they were like landing the killing blow or what happened.
Right, but at least that was pretty strong evidence that Smilodon fed on
Mastodonia parks in Israel. Okay. Now, do we know if they hunted in packs or were they solitary?
They seem to have been solitary. And even in cases where you have really dense accumulations of predators, predator traps like the La Brea tar pits, you usually only get isolated Smilodon. The same is actually true for most of the other saber-tooth mammals. They're all pretty rare.
Now, I was just looking at this saber-toothed tiger. Does it have retractable, or did it have retractable claws like they do in modern lions and cats?
Okay. Yep. These the saber teeth are just one subfamily of the felids. They're nested well within the modern cat radiation.
And is there any idea or a hypothesis on why they died out and went extinct?
It's almost certainly related to the extinction of the megafauna they fed on at the end of the Ice Age.
And what were the main prey that was, you mentioned mastodon?
Mastodon, the giant ground sloth, woolly rhino, even maybe like glyptodonts, the giant armadillos. All the really big herbivorous mammals, the megafauna, that died at the end of the Pleistocene, probably through a combination of climate change and human hunting.
Human hunting, right. The Blitzkrieg
hypothesis. Okay.
Well, Christian, thanks so much for your time. Man, this has been really educational for me, and I know my students back in Egypt are going to love hearing about this stuff.
No problem.
Thanks for joining us. I'd love to have you out to Egypt, and maybe he can tell us some more about the whales of Wadi Halfdan someday.
Oh, I hope so.
All right. See you guys.
Grievous sort of heel damage on the side caused by sort of interspecific agonistic.
That's wild.
Yeah, this is a Megaceratops. This is the big American one. There's one that's even crazier actually around the corner, which is Imbolotherium, the Mongolian form, where it not only has the horn, the Y-shaped horn on the snout, but a plate of bone that extends up the skull and actually forms a crest over the
ears. Almost like Triceratops.
Yeah, it really is sort of the mammalian answer to Triceratops.
That's so cool. And these rib marks, these cracked ribs, are probably from males fighting and competing for access to
territory and females, just like the rams today. That one over there is the mastodon. That's Mammoth American, the American mastodon. This one's a gomphotherium, which is a more primitive group, ancestral to both mastodons and mammoths. And you can tell a mastodon from a mammoth. They're both big elephant-like critters. But mastodons still have lower teeth. So you see their lower tusks sticking out
on the bottom.
And even in the mastodon, there's a little one sticking out.
Yeah.
Also, they have these very sort of lumpy molars with a bunch of ridges on them. Whereas elephants have what's called loxodont dentition. They have these incredibly fine parallel ridges of enamel that are highly adapted for grinding through grass and other very very resistant plant matter, especially things with phytoliths in it, little silica crystals that just tear your teeth apart.
So this would have been one of the potential preys of Smilodon.
Yep.
That's very cool.
Baby Effie. So this is really a calf of the woolly mammoth. Most of the fur has fallen off of the mummy, but there's still a little bit down on the leg.
Yeah.
So this is the head here. There's an eye. There's the tusk root. Here's the trunk. And then there would be the ear. And then this is the left forelimb there.
Mm-hmm. And they were able to extract DNA from this specimen?
They haven't tried that yet. They've completely sequenced the mitochondrial genome of the woolly mammoth, but based on more complete mummies from Siberia.
Yeah.
This one, I think they've had it for like 80 years, and they didn't take any tissue samples as soon as it thawed.
As good as they are today, you probably can get some out of the skin.
So where did they find this one?
This is also in Siberia.
Very close relative of the woolly. This is the one that lived in further south, only in North America. Woolly mammoth lived in the sort of the tundra of all the northern continents, so like Alaska, Canada, Europe, and Siberia. But this guy was living in what's sort of now Middle America, from California east to the Carolinas, all through that belt. And so this is probably wouldn't have been furred like the woolly mammoth. We've reconstructed it here, hairless like an elephant.
Mm-hmm.
who's living in such warm climates.
Yes,
but it's almost as big as the woolly mammoth. All the mammoths get really huge, the tallest of which, the Chinese steppe mammoth, a subspecies of Mammuthus tragontherii, would have been up to 17 feet at the shoulder.
Wow. Amazing. Teeth again.
So you've got, to tell the difference between a mammoth and a mastodon, a lot of it's in the teeth. So a mastodon is a primitive member of the elephant family, which has this, what's called bunodont dentition. It's the same type of teeth that we have, in which each of the sort of the grinding cusps is sort of very low and relatively circular. It's like a mound. Bunodont actually means mound tooth in Greek. Whereas mammoths and modern elephants are each other's closest relatives, closer to each other than either is to the mastodon. They have what's called loxodont dentition, which means slanting tooth. They have these slanting parallel rows of very thick enamel all along the molar surface. This is highly resistant to very tough plants, especially grasses. So grasses are filled with essentially tiny shards of glass, these phytoliths. And that's just terrible for mammal teeth. It grinds them down. A lot of mammals have evolved either very tall teeth or perpetually growing teeth, like rodents, to be able to deal with the harshness of the eating grass. And you know, as you can see, mammoths did the same thing. They have this very tough enamel surface and then this very deep root, which is sort of perpetually going out. If they get to very old age, mammoths would eventually run out of teeth. So they had the regular mammalian complement of molars, but they would come out one by one in sort of a marching molar pattern. The same thing is actually present in manatees, which are the closest living relatives of elephants. But eventually you are going to run out of those because it's not like reptiles. Mammals have a set number of teeth. So very old elephants you know, can die of starvation if all their teeth have been lost.
Yeah, eventually they all fall out.
Well, that was an excellent lesson on how tooth morphology and shape actually help you say infer something about the ecology of an organism that has been long since extinct. Mm-hmm.